Stand by to go live, Bob.
I would like to say to whoever has my children, please bring them home.
In 1995, just 2 years before baby Sabrina vanished, all eyes were on this woman, Susan Smith.
State intends to seek the death penalty.
The tearful young South Carolina mom told police her young sons were abducted during a carjacking.
We have to remember the timing of Sabrina's disappearance. They were functioning under the cloud of Susan Smith.
In a gruesome turn, Smith would later confess that she drove her own children into a lake, letting them drown, hoping to win the affection of a boyfriend who said he didn't want children.
They did not want to follow in those steps. They wanted to solve the case and not be upheld to public ridicule because of their investigation.
Now, here in Florida, the public and police are wondering if Marlene Aisenberg is just the latest mom-turned-murderer.
We love her very much and need her to come home.
But like we say,
when I first met the couple 20 years ago, suspicion had already engulfed their lives.
Does it get any easier?
No.
Never.
All these years later and still no answers. What really happened in this Tampa suburb in the middle of the night? Was it a kidnapping, as the Aisenbergs say? Or do they know more than they're letting on?
Now, there's a very serious story out of Florida that's making national headlines.
The investigation into that question transfixes the national media.
It created a media frenzy.
In Florida, the FBI is now involved in the search for a missing
baby. Deputies expanded their search for Sabrina.
Today, the frantic mother cried out in grief.
When they come to the home, there are a lot of suspicious circumstances.
It struck fear into the hearts and the minds of families all over the country. To think that while you're asleep and your child is one room away, that they could be taken.
When Marlene's polygraphs come back inconclusive, police turn up the heat.
I couldn't believe it. I just was answering everything they said. You know, they would throw, you know, oh, you're under stress, and I would, no, I'm not under stress. You know, I have three beautiful children.
At that time, I said, are you charging us with anything? Did we do anything? He said no to those questions. And then I said, then I'd like to see, talk to an attorney.
That didn't sit well with the public or the police.
And they don't hire just any lawyer. They take on famed Florida attorney Barry Cohen.
They're doing a half-assed job of trying to find Sabrina.
I first spoke to Cohen back in 1998.
These are parents of a kidnapped child. Why do they need a lawyer?
They were being accused of a crime that they didn't commit. And anybody that's accused of a crime that they didn't commit sure needs a lawyer pretty badly.
Today, Cohen is waging a more personal battle, fighting cancer.
We're at the cul-de-sac where the Aisenbergs live.
So we caught up with his old team who helped defend the Aisenbergs, lawyers Todd Foster and Steve Romine, and private investigator Kevin Calwary.
Did you all make a conscious decision to cut them off from police and cooperation?
Yes, we sensed that the sheriff's office wasn't as interested in solving the case as they were making a case against the Aisenbergs.
Law enforcement look at that is that, well, they must be trying to hide something. If you're not guilty of anything, just being honest is going to help the cops find your child.
In the days following Sabrina's disappearance, police mount a massive search on the ground, in the air, and in the water surrounding the family home.
Detectives say the bloodhounds were onto something.
At the time, it was the largest land and water search in Florida history.
And with the couple refusing to talk, it sets up a standoff between the parents and the police.
As far as the questions that we would like to ask them, they need to come in and sit down with us to have a formal interview.
Lieutenant Greg Brown was the sheriff's office spokesperson in 1998.
Can you understand their reluctance?
No, I can't, because as a parent, I would want my child back, and I would do whatever it takes to get my child back.
If you have nothing to hide, why not just tell the police anything and everything and let them say anything and everything?
We tried. We called the police a week ago and said we would come in and talk to them as long as it could be taped and our attorney could be present,
and they said no. They don't want the information to find Sabrina. They want the information to close a case. They've even said to our relatives, we're not looking for a baby, we're looking for a body. How would you feel as a parent when you heard that? Does that make you feel open to talking to them?
So while police continue their massive search, the Aisenbergs attend candlelight vigils surrounded by supporters and work to get Sabrina's picture out far and wide.
I smile at every baby I see to see if it smiles back, and if it does, I know it might be Sabrina.
And while they aren't talking to police, they are talking to the media.
We are now joined by Marlene and
appearing
Steve
on Good Morning America, Oprah, and 2020.
Tonight, we take you inside this explosive case.
Then, 2 months after Sabrina vanished, the Aisenbergs find themselves in danger of losing their two other children as well, this time at the hands of Florida's Child Protective Services.
How frightening was it for you that the Department of Children and Family Services showed up and started looking at your other children?
It was scary as hell.
You know what? We left the room and let them interview our children. And after they left, they said, these kids are great. There's nothing wrong in this household.
A week later, the couple back on the hot seat, this time with federal prosecutors asking questions in front of a grand jury.
Either one of you have anything you want to say.
But if authorities think they'll finally get the Aisenbergs talking again, they are wrong.
Steve and Marlene Aisenberg were silent as they walked into the federal courthouse, and apparently they also had little to say before the federal grand jury.
You would think that naturally parents of a child that had gone missing would spill everything they know in the hope that maybe it could help the investigation. That's not what happened. The Aisenbergs took the Fifth Amendment at grand jury.
Why?
Well, that's what we were advised to do from our attorney.
Because it was a stacked deck, in our view, against them.
But you understand that to a lot of people, it didn't look good for them to take the Fifth.
Plenty of people that are innocent take the Fifth. If there's somebody on the other side that has an intent to try and hurt you, you can tell the truth. But they take your words and they spin it to fit what they want.
How did this ordeal affect this family?
It ran them out of town. They had to leave Tampa. It was just untenable for them to remain in this community.
Nearly 2 years after Sabrina vanished, the family moves to Maryland, back into Steve's childhood home.
One of the biggest reasons we were moving was because we couldn't raise our children to respect the authorities there.
But the Aisenbergs discover that 1,000 miles cannot protect them from determined Florida authorities.
They busted in my front door.
Who will reveal that they have secret tapes.
So you never heard the baby's dead and buried, it was found dead because you did it.
Hi everyone, George Stephanopoulos here. Thanks for checking out the ABC News YouTube channel. If you'd like to get more videos, show highlights, and watch live event coverage, click on the right over here to subscribe to our channel, and don't forget to download the ABC News app for breaking news alerts. Thanks for watching.